Divine Truth. Name of this presentation is Damnations and Divine Truth. This is session 2. And it is part of Lessons in Love series. It was presented in Murgon, Queensland, Australia, on the 15th of December, 2012.
Well, welcome everyone to our weekend program. We've actually got quite the program lined up for you guys this weekend. And I'm briefly going to run through how we're going to organise things. First up, I'm going to talk to you all about something that I spoke to the book group about a few weeks ago. It's actually an extension of the session that I did then. And that session was called Donations and Divine Truth. And today is Donations and Divine Truth Session 2. So that's me first up. Then Lena and Igor would like to get up and say a couple of things at the end of that. Then we'll take a break. We might need it. After that, Jesus and I will be giving a presentation about the God's Way of Love organisation for the second half of today. And then we'll all go home and have a big rest. And then if you decide to join us tomorrow, the first session we'll be doing is on the Law of Desire, and which is a lovely topic. And the second session will be called What is Your Treasure? And it's a bit of a treasure of a talk, I reckon. My soulmate will be giving that one on his own. So that's what we have lined up. As you know, we are not short of a word. So hopefully we'll fit it all in the allocated time, because this is our last seminar planned at the moment. So we probably won't have the chance to follow up too soon after that. Adjust my mic, I'm a bit poppy. Yeah, we tried to fix this beforehand. Okay. Is that okay? Heavy breathing. It's everything in this weekend. Yeah. Okay. So I just wanted to point out that if you don't want to be here for one of those sessions, that's cool. You don't have to stay and listen to me talk about donations, but you're welcome to come back and hear about God's way of love and any of the sessions tomorrow, of course. You're well informed, so I don't expect you to feel like you need to sit through whatever's going on if you don't want to. Okay? Sound all right? All right. Okay, so a couple of weeks ago, I announced that I would be stopping doing book group. We'd done about 20 sessions, I think, working through one of the books by Robert James Lees. And I did that because the donations that I was receiving to do the book group were not covering the expenses that we were incurring to put it together each week and then for Lena and Igor to edit it and put it up on YouTube. So that was a good decision, I think, on my part. I saw it as a decision to act more ethically and more lovingly towards myself. But as I made that announcement, I realised that I needed to make that choice, and I felt it would be really beneficial for the group to hear about why and how I'd made the decision to stop. I felt there was a lot of issues of love inherent in the decision and some things that some of the people in the group were looking over. Sorry, say that again. Issues that some of the people in the group were overlooking when they were coming to book group. Now, can I just ask who of you was at that session? Oh yeah, good amount of you. And anyone who wasn't there, have you since watched the clip on YouTube? Yeah, 3 or 4 of you, yep. Yeah, few, okay, yeah. I'm asking that because I'm not going to actually go over what I said in that session. Today's session is an extension of that session. So I'm briefly going to recap the points that we covered there, but then I want to say a few more things. Because since I gave that talk, I have received some further questions via email, And I've had some other experiences around that decision that showed me that I needed to clarify what was happening and to extend perhaps the lessons in love. So, sound all right? Yep. Now, who was at that session and was there and was fairly confronted and felt like, oh, okay, now that's over, that's a relief, and hasn't thought about it since? Nobody's got their hand up, but I'm pretty sure there's a lot of you who haven't really given it much deep consideration. I've heard a few things that have shown me that also. Who was there and felt like, and feel free to be really honest, guys, who was there and was like, well, it's just book group. It's not anything really much. And it's Mary's thing that she likes to do. And it's actually her law of attraction anyway, that she's not getting enough donations. Who had that kind of thought? Two people. Yep. And can you see the issue of the lesson of love that you're overlooking there, you guys? No. No. That's because you're pretty unhappy with me at the moment, Trev. So hopefully we'll explain it as I go on. I can tell you it was more than two people. Because by the end of that session, by the time I'd finished packing the van, I had at least three, perhaps four people come up and tell me that exact thing. That they weren't that concerned that it was over. I'd shown them what to do. They could do book group on their own. And it wasn't really an issue anymore. So if three or four people told me to my face, I'm suspecting quite a few others thought it. To me, it's okay. It's okay if you don't find value in what I present. But my question is, why do you attend? Because it doesn't make sense. It can only be for some kind of addictive purpose, can't it? And if you think about the presentation I gave, it was addressing a lot of those addictive patterns that I see in people who come to our talks. So that shows me that a lot of the lessons were skipped over. And I've actually since had some emails from people around the world feeling that what I did was not the right thing to do and that I should really keep giving even though I can't cover my costs, and I should definitely never mention donations because that's wrong. So some of these experiences and some of these letters have prompted me to realise that perhaps I need to talk about a few more things with everyone. But can I recommend that if you want to see the full teaching on these lessons, that you actually, and you haven't viewed the first session, that you need to view that as well. Because as I said, I'll just briefly summarise what we went through. Who can remember some of the things that I talked about there? Deirdre? Have we got mic runners? We do, Alex, thank you.
We honour our financial life over spirit life. I remember you just writing that. I remember that one. But no? Okay.
Yeah, what do you think I meant by that though, Deirdre?
That we have such that we have such ingrained fears around money or lack of money, but what that actually means... I'm not explaining myself, sorry. We just have so much fear about the lack of money and just we can't afford that we give no thought to anything else beyond that.
Yeah, I talked, didn't I, about people not having an awareness. Of what goes into a presentation that AJ and myself give. And the reason that we're talking about this subject here today is because everything that I spoke about actually applies to the seminar that AJ usually gives as well. So we said that people don't have much awareness of what goes into it, and there are a lot of reasons why they actually don't want to have one. And one of them was that they feel that they don't have enough, they can't get by themselves, so they're just going to take and not really think about who they're taking from and how much they're taking, because their financial fears, not even their security, is far more important than being ethical. Yeah. Can anyone else remember any other lesson I said, or any other reason I said I was stopping book group? If we go here, yep.
The big one I remember, Mary, was that you said that most of, or many of us, are still ashamed and embarrassed about Jesus and Mary.
Yeah, I talked about why a lot of people don't have gratitude for what they receive, or they don't value what for what they receive at, say, a Divine Truth seminar. And often that's because, if you think about it, if you just cottoned on to the most amazing truth on the planet, and wouldn't you just be running around telling all of your friends, sharing it as much as you could, supporting it as much as you could? Now, many of you have told me this is the most amazing truth. Finally, my life makes sense. I've felt some of these things all my life, and then suddenly I found it presented, and actually to greater degree than what I felt, and I can apply this to everything, and it just gives meaning to everything. And yet, there's not much sharing that goes on, is there? There's not always very much acting on what you hear. And certainly, there's not the support via donations that you would think you would receive if that's how people really felt. And that is often because people are ashamed to say that they know Jesus and Mary Magdalene. And it really, you can feel that in you, can't you? Yeah, I don't want to seem like I'm a nutter. I'll just keep this quietly to myself. And when then they just talk about this stuff more publicly, and when they're on the telly, actually, I kind of hate it now. That means that you don't actually value what you're receiving. You're actually in opposition to what you're receiving. What's another reason I listed where you might be? Anna, did you have a question?
No, I just said something.
Just wait for the mic, yeah. You need the microphone? Yeah. This is another issue of love with the microphone, guys. I've spoken about it a few times at book group. Every one of you, almost, has been to a seminar before, and you know how things work. And most of you have been coming for 4 years, and you know about the microphones. Many of you have also complained in the past when you couldn't hear the audio. Oh, I couldn't hear what that person was saying, or, yeah, on the video. That was fine. I could hear AJ, but I couldn't hear what anyone else was saying. And yet, when it comes to using the microphone, often you guys are like, la, 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 I'm talking out here. I just want to say one thing. Just let me say it, without actually showing the respect for everyone else here and for the recording that's going on. So, what I've said in the past is that I don't actually want to remind people anymore to hold the mic close to their mouth. I've done it, I don't know how many times. I've watched AJ do it maybe 300 times. My feeling is, if you guys aren't aware enough and in your body enough to know that you can't hear you through the speakers, then I'm just going to say, keep passing the mic. And not give an explanation. I have done that in book group before. Okay, Anna.
I was just going to say, another thing that you talked about.
Yep.
You spoke about valuing things that are free less than what we pay for. We feel like when we're paid for it, then we'll sit down and take notes, and we'll take it on, we'll act on it a lot more.
Yes. Yep. So because there's a no price tag, on Divine Truth, we don't see it as having much value. Whereas if we pay $5,000 to go to that weekend seminar, oh yeah, you bet I'm listening. I'm taking notes. I'm engaged. But a lot of people, hey, how many hours is on YouTube for free at your fingertips anytime you want? And now there's transcripts and booklets, and we're here giving talks and doing book groups, and you know, it becomes so much that it's moved from a gift to an expectation for many people. We just came back from Summerfest, which was an awesome week. But by the time I got back, there were already people in my inbox saying, when are we going to see the stuff from Summerfest? That, I didn't go, but I want to see what happened. This is how much feeling there is that we will provide these things for free. And yet I do feel that there's little value placed on them because we don't charge. Yeah. Thanks, Anna. Anyone else? What was another reason I said that often divine truth isn't valued? If we go to, Geraldine and then Laureline.
It was to do with gratitude again, and to do with us not having much money in our lives, and so feeling that we don't have the money to give. And you said that if we were truly aware of all that we're being given in our life, from one day to the next, and all the charity that's being shown to us, that we would be looking at ourselves and questioning, why do I not have the money, and how can I show my gratitude, and how can I actually respond to this gift?
Yeah, and we did talk, and I would like to talk more about it today, that gratitude is not demonstrated just through dollars and cents. You would agree with that, wouldn't you? But when there are no dollars and cents coming in, often it is a reflection of the lack of gratitude for what is being offered. And we talked about the fact that there are other ways that you can show your gratitude, by helping out, by assisting in the delivery of divine truth. But we talked about the fact that most people say that they have gratitude, but they don't actually donate anything. And when they go to assist, they expect those people who are already giving the gift to give them more time, to train them, to help them, to help. Now, that doesn't make sense really, does it? If you come to be of service and I end up serving you, that's not good time management, is it? That takes me away from serving other people. So we talked about taking responsibility for that. For if I really feel I have gratitude and I can't donate, well, aren't I looking at, I have a wealth of teachings that talk to me about the law of attraction and what's happening and why I might not be attracting things, which is something that I've been applying also. But also, if I say I'm grateful, what are the other ways that I could be serving that I'm ignoring? And how am I expecting other people to facilitate my service? Because that is not a gift then. Yeah. Okay, Laureline?
Thanks. It made me reflect more on my self-reliance and God-reliance, that I wasn't willing to step over the line of God-reliance because I make decisions based on how I feel I can manage myself in situations, regardless of just the talk, it's just how I present myself. And I have to do so much for myself, rather than if I allow God to come into my life, I can be God-reliant, but I'm still so self-reliant. And it reflects in many things, and that just happened to be one of them.
So you're saying that your feeling of lack, really, is what you're talking about, caused you to value what I must get done over the gift you're receiving?
Yeah.
Yep. What other things did I list as reasons why I had come to this decision? Ange?
Just the truths that book group brings up for us, how resistant we are to those personal truths.
Yeah, I talked about a resistance to personal truth. And if you think about that, that's often a reason why we don't feel grateful, isn't it? Some of you come to these talks and you get someone be very direct with you about what's in play for you right then, or how you're actually not as loving as you think you thought. Thought you were. And so because there's a resistance to that feels like an affront. It doesn't feel like a gift. It feels like, oh, something I've got to endure. Oh, I don't really feel like giving after that. None of my addictions got met. I just feel like, oh, Wow, there's so much there. Who feels like that? Yeah, lots of times. Lots of people, hey? And I'll say to you that unless we're open to personal truth, there is an extreme limit on how close we can grow to God. We can't grow. If we're only able to grow as much as we're open to personal truth. We must know ourselves if we're going to know God. It's a quintessential truth of the path, of everything that we teach. So if you're already in a state of resistance to personal truth, you're pretty stunted, hey? Personal. Yep. And that was probably the final thing I listed, that a lot of people have developed addiction around the way that we do things. Does anyone remember some of the things I listed about that? No? Sandy?
Hello. The fact that we just come and we have this happy pill given to us at each seminar that you give to us, and then we just feel happy for a while, we just received some love from you, and then we go off and never apply the actual truth that you give to us.
Yeah, I'm going to say that my plan is to be fairly honest and upfront with you guys today. And the feeling that I have for a lot of you, I'm not saying all of you, but a lot of you, is that you come, now especially when Jesus is giving a talk, you come and it's like this sort of waterfall of really lovely feelings gets washed out there. And you just, wow, this guy is onto something. He's really nice too, except when he gives me that personal truth bit and then I'm like reconsidering. But this is good stuff, hey? Wow, yeah, that's awesome. That is so good. Yeah, wow. Oh my gosh, I can see that. Yeah, okay. Wow, this is amazing. There's this feeling. And then everyone walks out the door and not much happens. I've known some of you for 4 years and we're still having the same conversations. When we have a question and answer session, I hear the same questions, which shows me there's not a lot of application of what is being presented. There's a feeling of resonance with it, but there's not much else happening. And that's a lot of the reason why we haven't scheduled any more seminars. We feel like we've got to look at some things about the way we've been presenting divine truth, but also that you guys are at saturation level. The majority are at saturation level of intellectual understanding of a set of truths, and until you apply it, those things are fairly meaningless in your life, actually. Do you understand what I mean by that? Yeah, yeah. So there's a lot of addiction that goes on, I feel, surrounding just the feelings. Sometimes I feel there's not even a connection with the words. There's just the feelings. And then a lot of you now have a feeling of, and I get to have personal time with them. And then when you get that opportunity to have personal time, there's often more of a feeling of gratitude. Oh, yeah, you know, he talked to me for half an hour about my personal issues and oh, I feel like, yeah, that's good. Okay, right. I can really learn from that. But my question is, and I'll go through some of the statistics we talked about last time as well, but the fact that we get far more donations when we give an in-person seminar compared to when we put an interview on YouTube indicates this level of disparity. It shows me that people are not valuing the truth offered, they're valuing something else. If they were valuing the truth offered, they would have an equal response to information being presented. But that doesn't happen. So it's showing some addiction. I feel that many people have this expectation that Mary and Jesus are going to give me feedback on this personal issue. And for myself personally, just speaking for myself personally here, this is my feeling about my life's passion. My life's passion is to present divine truth to others. I want them to know how awesome God is and the potentials for our soul. I want them to know. And if I can live an example that might show that, I'd die happy, even though I'm not dying. You know, I will feel that I'm engaged in something worthwhile. And if my example inspires others to explore their own relationship with God, I'm really happy too. But what I do not desire is to handhold people in their relationship with God. It's impossible. And I don't desire to spend time talking to people about their personal emotions. It's not my favourite pastime. And I feel it's often very meaningless. At times, I share about my own personal experience and my growth through that experience. And that is hopefully, well, it does give you guys the opportunity to reflect. And as you know, anyone who's come to book group, self-reflection is like one of my favourite things. it gives all of you the opportunity to reflect, wow, is that relevant for me? Could I learn something about myself? Perhaps what has happened there, I could do that as well and I might grow through it. But that's very different to me sitting down with you and saying, see, what's happening there is this issue with your mum, and if you deal with that, then, and all of that takes away all of your personal reflective time and time for you to spend relating with God about those issues. You become me-reliant rather than God-reliant. And it's, AJ and I were speaking about this spoon-feeding kind of idea about spoon-feeding or holding people's hand all the way through things. Now, I'm not saying that I'll never talk to anyone about their personal emotions ever again. Because I do feel that as we're developing, it's worthwhile, if I have lived through something that might help you, to give you a few pointers. This is what I did, or I found it was about this. But what I see as concerning is when a group of people come and there is an amazing, like sometimes, honestly, guys, I sit here in this audience when my partner is speaking and I just go, this is so beautiful. This is so amazing. Like the ramifications of what's being spoken about is just beyond, you know, it could transform our lives so amazingly if we applied this. They're the times when I joke and I say, I just want to stand up at the end and clap and have the streamers and the balloons cut from the ceiling, because that's the moment for me. I'm like, wow. And then I see someone put up their hand and go, I've got this situation with my pet and I'm just wondering, like, do you think it's... And I think, hey, my goodness, you've just been given the tools to sort that out yourself. Why are you asking that question? It doesn't make sense to me. It can only be because there's some addiction in play and the sincere desire to really grow ourselves has somehow waned, or it was never there in the first place. Okay. So that's what we talked about last time. Who's excited for this time? This is not the most fantastic whiteboard, so. I just wanted to point out, before we get into some of the lessons of love, I often have had a resistance to talking to people about when they've been unloving towards myself and AJ. You've noticed it probably. I freeze up, I flake out, I go, oh, I just want to sit down. It's really hard. Now, I realise a lot of that for me has been about trying to control people's response. I want you to all like me while we tell you some confronting truth. I'm letting that go. Because honestly, in my own journey, when I've received confronting truth, sometimes I've wobbled quite a bit. And it's taken me a while. Sometimes I got cranky. Sometimes I wanted to shut down. Sometimes I went away. And I'd like to afford all of you guys the same opportunity, I suppose, or have compassion for the fact that maybe some confronting truth might make you wobble a little bit as well. So I've looked at my selfish side of this issue, which is partly why I'm talking to you guys today in a far more relaxed way. But there is another issue, and it surrounds sharing truth with people who perhaps are not that open to it. So let's just go through, especially around ethics, what I was feeling about before I started this talk was about how do you talk to people about ethics when they've already decided to ignore some previous teachings about ethics. But I wanted to put to you the question, what do we do when we're loving? What is it that we do when someone gives us a gift of truth? How do we respond? What does that look like? No idea, yeah. Diana? Thanks,
Pete. For myself to be open, and if I'm not feeling open, to reflect on why I'm afraid and what's going on for me, but to be open to receive it, to reflect on it, to pray about it.
So when we're loving and we receive a gift, or when we're, let's say when we're offered a gift, you're saying we actually receive it, we're open to it. When loving, we are, open to receive, let's say. I'm always saying this whiteboard writing is a developing skill. It's surprisingly strange how little you can spell when you get up here and try doing this. I wouldn't call myself a bad speller, but gee whiz, it all goes out the window. Okay, when we're loving and someone offers us a gift, any kind of gift, we're open to receive it. What else do we do if we honour that gift? Barbara?
We would express our gratitude.
We'd be grateful. And how might we express our gratitude? What would that look like, do you think?
It depends on what the gift is.
Yeah.
If it's a physical gift, a thank you is usually enough. I really appreciate this. I can use it or use the gift they're given.
Yeah.
If it's a gift...
So there's two things you've said there. We might say something, like express verbally our thanks. But then you said something important. We would use it, wouldn't we?
Yes.
And actually using our gift is a part of showing, isn't it, that we value it?
Yes. That's demonstrating your gratitude.
Gratitude, yep. Mm. Yep. Anything else? Any other way that we show we value a gift?
And if it was a gift of truth...
Yes.
You would then be open and willing and to receive that truth and
would you...
I would pray to God to show me the truth of that truth that I can...
Show me the truth of the truth, yeah. Can we say you might... Or that you
it.
Would act on it. If you received a gift of truth, you were open to it, you felt it was a gift, you had gratitude for it, you would give you would express your thanks in some way to the giver, probably. But the way that you would show really that you value this thing, that you're grateful for it, is that you would use it and you would act upon it. It would add to your life. Your life would change as a result, wouldn't it? Yeah. Okay. What would we do if we've actually been in an unloving state, an addictive state with someone, in receiving gifts, and it was pointed out to us, and we were a reasonably humble kind of a person, what would we do then? Anyone? Yeah, if we go Jen. Yep.
feel it genuinely, and then take immediate action that it didn't happen again, and kept feeling through the whole process.
So when you say we'd keep feeling, can you be more specific?
Having just been through this, I removed myself immediately so that the addiction could not occur again, even though I didn't have all the information or hadn't completely felt through it.
And so you would take action that prevented your addiction being maintained, okay?
Preventing from continuing.
Take action to...
Even though I didn't have all the information.
Yeah.
So I hadn't gotten through the end of the cause of it.
Yep, okay. And Anna had your hand up beside you. What would you do, Anna?
I was just going to say, I would say sorry and, like, not let it happen again.
Yeah, so you take action to not do it again. But what else might you do if you're a humble kind of a character, Jason?
There might be some feelings of repentance that you might go through the process.
And what would start that process? What would you have to do to start it?
Take responsibility and feel the effects that you've had on other person.
And even before that, you just have to reflect, wouldn't you? You just self-reflect. Okay, what's in this for me? Oh, there must be something because I've recognised, yeah, I can see there's an addiction. So we'd self-reflect at least, wouldn't we? Can you see that when somebody points out an unloving behaviour and you go, oh, well, you receiving that's just your law of attraction, bypasses a lot of self-reflection, doesn't it? Bypasses a lot of the teachings, actually. If we recognise that we are engaged in relationships with other people and we're responsible for our own soul and our own actions, when someone points out an unloving action and you can go to them, well, it's your law of attraction. Now, that might be true in that they have attracted this unloving event, but you saying that is a huge deflection of all self-reflection, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. What else? We change our actions. We take responsibility. We self-reflect. And we recognise that we've been taking advantage of someone else's generosity. This is what we'd do if we're self-reflective. Now, what if we don't want to be self-reflective? What does it look like then? Deirdre, yeah? Okay. I'm looking forward to this answer. Yeah.
We rebel like hell.
Rebel like hell. Mm, yes.
From my own personal experience.
Indeed. So, what would that look
like? Serious. I'm sorry, I'm joking, but it is, it's quite serious. But
yes.
Yeah, sorry.
So when we don't self-reflect, when we don't want to be loving, well, I'll just say when we don't want to do anything. Okay. We rebel. And how might we act towards the people who've been trying to teach us this lesson of love? Barbara?
First of all, we'd be angry, but we'd also want to blame somebody else. We wouldn't want to take the blame ourselves.
Anger, sorry, Barbara, what was the last thing that you said? Blame.
Yep, anger and blame.
Yep. Now, there's something else that I commonly see happen. And it involves, yes, Suzanne, perhaps you know.
I was just going to say, it's probably not necessary, but a lot of self-justification.
Self-justification, yes. I didn't know any better. You know, you're just teaching me about this. How can I be expected to know? Yep, which self-justification, which helps us avoid self-responsibility. Max?
Hi, Mary.
Hi.
Judgment, judging them.
Judgment, yeah.
Saying they don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah, that's all things that we use, isn't it, to distance ourselves from this person and this truth. Yep. I'm judging you, I'm rebelling, I'm angry, I'm justifying. How could I know any better? All those kinds of things. Yes. Now, there's something else that happens that I see. Bruce? It happens a lot with AJ and myself.
Yeah, you deny it.
Deny it, yeah. Nothing to see, yep, yep. Deny it. Okay. The thing that that perhaps doesn't happen so much in your life, but happens in our life quite a lot, is this. We point out an issue of love with someone, and then they say to us, oh, okay, do you think that's about my mum? Could you give me some help with that now? Could you? And we actually, the actual underlying dynamic that is happening is that we're saying, you're actually not being loving in your interaction with me. And you're saying, great, thanks for that. Now could you help me to deal with that? Could you give me some more of your time and attention so that I can understand that better? Can anyone see an issue with that? So a lot of you can't because you do it. So you think it's reasonable. Barbara?
Well, it's true what you say. It's a demand and it's very unloving.
Yeah.
And it's not also respecting the person either, yourselves. Mm.
Yeah, you can put it really graphically, I suppose, if you think about violence. You know, if I come up and punch you, Barbara, on the arm and you say, gee, Mary, that hurt quite a bit. That's actually not a very kind thing to do. And I went, ah, thanks, Barb. Could you tell me why you reckon I would have done that? This is why sometimes I feel resistive to talking. I had two emails during the week where people said, right, okay, thanks for that. Could you just please tell me, though, because I don't really understand, could you tell me more about that? I've watched it once, but I'd like you, two people said, I'd like you to give another seminar about that. Now, I'm not giving this seminar for that reason. Ironically, I'm giving this seminar because I can see there's an issue with expectation, with someone actually saying, thanks for pointing out that I've been taking you for granted. Could you please explain to me how and why that's occurred? That just sometimes feels a bit off to me. But I do know that someone very loving, patient and kind has spent a long time with me repeating himself and pointing out issues that I've just been a no-brainer on because of my emotional resistance. So I do feel it's worthwhile. Let's talk about it again. And if it's confronting for everyone again, that's okay, you know. I've been confronted a lot as well. And you're worth my time to talk about this some more. So. But I just wanted to point out the issue with when we have to coach people into being ethical. Already there's a lot of resistance to the ethics, isn't there? Okay. Now, my next question for you is, what constitutes a gift? What is the definition of a gift? Nobody knows. Is it all up for question now? Can I really encourage you to be very honest with me today? If you feel like, nah, Mary, I don't really agree with anything you're saying here. This all just stinks of something bad now. Tell me, you know, say, hang on, I don't get this. Isn't divine truth for free? Now you're talking about donations. What is this? Because I can't address the issues that you have unless you raise them. And I'm really happy to address those issues. But let's talk. What's a gift, Yvonne?
Something that's freely given without expectation from one person to another. And I guess inherent in that is with the belief that you think it's of value to the other person.
Okay, so it's freely given without expectation. What else did you say?
I said behind a gift would be the feeling that it is of value to the other person?
Yeah, so if I'm giving a gift, it's a heartfelt feeling, isn't it? And it's a feeling that there is no obligation on you as I give this gift. It's a pure desire that I want to do this. And if I feel it's a gift, I suppose I do feel it's valuable to you. I want you to receive something that is of value or worth or good for you. Yes, okay. What else? Rob?
It's an expression of love for the other person.
Yeah, so can we say there's a pure desire? To express love. Yep, I like that. Through this giving. Yep. Renee?
A true gift is given unconditionally.
Unconditionally, yes. Yeah. So there's no expectation or demand attached with it. Yeah, there's no condition upon the gift. Okay. And what is not present when I'm giving a gift? So there's no expectation or demand. And if we can be more specific.
No judgment.
There's no judgment.
Or when I say judgment, an expectation comes into it. No judgment or expectation to change, like.
Yeah, okay. So there's no investment. So there's no condition. No investment. No demand, yep. If we had those things, what would they constitute? Lawling? Awesome. Yvonne's in the moment, yeah.
A bargain.
Sorry?
A bargain.
There's no barter or bargain. Now, if we had barter, if we had investment, if we had condition, if we had expectations, if we had demands, we'd be in addiction. There is no addiction in giving. Does that sound all right? Any questions so far? Any questions with me saying divine truth is a gift? No? Okay. What does it mean when something is free? How do you define a free thing? Sandy?
No strings attached.
No strings attached. Yeah. Very similar to this definition, hey? And what about when we say free, like in this day and age, if we're speaking physically, there's no monetary charge, is there? There's no price tag, if we say that. Okay. So is everyone still happy that divine truth is a gift? If you're not, tell me, because I am standing up here giving a talk which is entitled Donations and Divine Truth. Okay, I'm going to talk more at the end of this talk about some of the questions that I've received and some of the false beliefs I feel people have around the way we should present divine truth to make it free and a gift that are not actually based in very much logic. But I feel very confident that both Jesus and myself give a gift to you guys that is free because it's our heartfelt desire and there is no conditional expectation upon you, that we value what we're giving you and it is an expression of our love and that we are not in addiction. I would say for myself in the early days, yes, I had addiction with you, which is why I choked so many times because my desire was being purified through that process, but I took it seriously. And I feel that now, when I do decide to speak with you, it is through this desire to be loving in this exchange with you. And we definitely do not have a price tag or charge entry at the door. Okay. Now, next set of questions. When would it be right to stop giving a gift to someone? If you're someone who has a gift, when would it be right to stop giving that gift? Okay, if we go to Cavill, we haven't heard from her, and then we'll come back to Deirdre on this side. Alex. Just go ahead, Cavill, when you're ready.
I'd stop giving the gift when it's not appreciated.
When it's not appreciated. Mm. And how could we tell it's not appreciated?
If it's not appreciated, it's...
What would be the clues we had that it's not being appreciated?
Be a lack of respect. The gift isn't being used.
Yep. So some of those things we mentioned before would be, wouldn't it? When we see people aren't using it, when we see that the gratitude is not shown through, not just through donations, but through the way they respond, the way they use the teachings, the level of expectation they have that they get more. Okay, so when to stop giving. What would be another reason I should stop giving? Yep, sorry, someone, Deirdre, go. Yep.
When it's being abused or misused.
So what would be, can you give an example of that? I can't do both things at once.
I guess, and I've heard it a lot, and I've probably said it myself too, but I do check myself, when someone says, oh, that's just your law of attraction, like that finger pointing, it's, to me, that's an abuse. It's an abuse of the truth.
Oh, I agree that's an abuse of the truth. But if I'm abusing a gift, what would that look like?
So if someone lent me a car and I crashed it and I didn't care.
Yeah. So I wrecked it and it didn't bother me. Yeah.
Yeah, and I didn't even pay them back for the damage I've done, like completely...
So when there's sort of a taking feeling and expectation inside of me?
Yeah.
Inside of the person receiving, I should say. And you said an abuse also, I would say, if someone was sort of profiteering off a gift, hey? If you were giving something really freely and then people were going off and selling it for $1 million and, you know, just having a high life and not really even considering where the money came from... Yeah, I'd be considering where the gift came from, rather. I'd be considering, is it really ethical for me to keep giving something at my own expense when someone else is just taking it and using it and abusing it, really, by charging for something that's been given freely and also making their livelihood from something where they're not respecting where gifts have come from? How many of you can relate to that in your own life where you've actually received things and realised later, wow, I've used that gift all through my life and when it was given to me, I hardly even noticed? It happens quite a lot if you think about it, even with physical things. You know, your favourite kitchen knife sometimes came from someone and you just took it but it's your... If you can't find that knife in the kitchen, you're like, it doesn't, you know, it's so much easier to cook with that knife. There's many gifts. And we talked about that in the last book group session and Geraldine mentioned it. The charity that's given to us that we just take for granted. Yeah. Okay, so a gift should stop being given under the following circumstances. There's some other things that you guys haven't mentioned. Yeah, Alwyn and Yvonne.
You're giving a gift that's not appreciated and you keep on giving it, it's not loving to yourself?
Yes, when you realise that you're actually harming yourself through the giving of this gift, you're ignoring the love of yourself through giving a gift to somebody else. Yep. Okay. So when you're harming yourself or when you are physically unable to do it anymore, and this is what happened with book group. I was just physically unable with the funds that we had to continue doing it. Yeah. When harming or not caring for yourself, let's say. Does anyone else have any ideas? Yep, Yvonne, yeah.
When the higher priority is just meeting people's addiction.
So when you notice addiction, yeah. Can we say when you notice addiction in the receiver or in yourself? If you're really a person of integrity, you'll stop giving a gift if you realise, wow, this is all about my addiction. I'm just using this to feel good. Yeah. Any other ideas? Yep. Rose and Jason?
You've got up there when not appreciated, but I think there's a difference between not appreciating the truth and the message, but also the hours and the your time.
So it's about not having gratitude, not only for the caliber of the gift, but also the effort that goes into creating the gift. Mm. Yes, I agree. Yep. Jason?
I can just really feel that when you guys are giving the gift of truth, but we're listening with our minds and not with our hearts open, and so we're not receiving it, and then you're just basically getting projections of violence back.
Yeah, there's a lot of heart. That's often what's happening. You know, there's a lot of heart resistance to what's being said, but a lot of nodding people. It's a very unusual situation to be in. That I've been in that, and when we gave the book group, I was in that. A lot of people almost went into a facade of saying, I'm so grateful. But the feeling I had was, I don't like that you're talking about money, because I've got a heap of stuff about money, and I want to keep that door closed. And this is very confronting. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So when we feel like over time that the heart is not engaged and that there's a rejection, do you disagree, babe? No. You want to add? Yep. Peter, if we just go to AJ, yep.
Yeah, I think one of the biggest reasons to not give any more is because you don't feel like it.
Yes, that was the first thing on my list, actually. When I don't feel like giving a gift, then I should stop. You know, when it's not my desire, you know, if it's a gift, there's no obligation for me to keep doing it. So if I don't want to, then I should stop, hey? Okay. Sound fair enough? Yeah. Elizabeth has a hand up at the back. Yep.
I had an experience several weeks ago at a garage sale. Last year I bought an awful lot of thongs that were very much in addiction, and I decided to put them in a garage sale, and I preempted by saying that whatever I'm offered for them, I will take. Now, they cost me $25 wholesale, and I know they sell them in Byron Bay for about $80, so I knew this would be quite an event. So I put them out, and all sorts of sizes. And one lady said, and I explained how much I'd paid for them.
Elizabeth, can everyone hear Elizabeth? No, okay. We can't hear you. So I'm tempted just to move on.
Okay, yep. That's fine.
Someone else had their hand up over here, Peter, yep. Just here, yep. If you just leave your hand up then, other Peter can find you, yep.
I was thinking the other reason for actually no longer giving the gift is, whilst you might still want to, there might be other priorities that such that within the given resources available, you might actually want to choose to do something else.
Yes, so you might. That's right. That might cause you not to want to do it anymore. Mm. You just feel like, actually, there's something more important I need to do right now, and so I'm not going to do it. Yeah, yeah. Very good point. Suzanne? Just
when you can see from the circumstances, they just don't need any more.
I just don't need to give.
No, the person doesn't need anymore.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, definitely.
At this point in time.
If you recognise that, well, what would be the things you'd recognise in the receiver? They don't need it. Why would I give it? What else? Yep. Renee and Glenda. Yep.
Like, if we haven't received and learnt emotionally the gifts that you guys had already given us, well, then, you know, we need to go back to the three truths of love, truth, humility, and then just keep on working on that.
Yeah, so if we notice in the receiver that they haven't valued the previous gifts, and that's something that I talked about a lot in the last session, yep. And, yep, Glenda?
Also stop giving when the other person actually doesn't want what you're trying to give.
Yes, yes.
Like, if I'm trying to help somebody,
yes.
Or I've had that experience, people trying to help me when you're not doing what I want, you're not helping.
I would not like this help just now, or I don't want this gift, yes. So if we don't need it, we don't want it, if it's not valued, if all of these things exist in the receiver, then, yeah, we would stop giving. Yep. Darling? Oh, you've got a mic on, I could just...
I have, but it's not switched on. Yeah, I feel there's the issue of not needing it. I don't agree, actually, on that subject. I feel that somebody might want it but not need it. And it's a pleasure to give things to people who want things, even if they don't need it.
Yes.
And I actually feel also from God's perspective, we don't need God's love to survive. We don't need God's love to live, you know, to live, but we have to want it before we can receive it. So, yeah, I feel that it's not just about needing it, it's also about does the person want it? They might not need it, but they might want it.
That's beautiful. I was thinking in very concrete terms that if I had six dining chairs and someone gave me six more, I don't need them. But, yes, I agree. Of course, yeah. Yeah, we're often showered. And sometimes isn't that the most moving thing? When somebody gives us something that we really just desire, but we don't need it. When I used to go shopping with my mum as a kid, you know, every pair of shoes I had that we purchased had to be useful in three or four settings in order for us to get value for money, you know. You know, are you going to be able to wear them with that? Can you wear them to school? Can you do that? You know, it was what do you need? You just got to get what you need. And so when I met AJ, he would just say, here, have this beautiful dress or a pair of shoes or whatever. And I'd be like, I don't need it. And it was overwhelming to receive something that I just loved but I didn't need. So I agree, yeah. Okay, did anyone else have their hand up? Yep, Deb.
Well, I have been in the situation in the past where I haven't wanted personal truth, but I probably sure as hell needed it, you know, so I'm grateful now that I kind of, a year later and I click, things start clicking, or a year and a half or whatever, but yeah. And I need it because I'm praying to God for it, but just, you know, like the prayers are sometimes ahead of my desire's often been ahead of my real willingness to deal with all that means.
Well, let's talk about that, Deb, because it's very hard for you to have a sincere desire for more personal truth I don't believe it's a sincere desire. If you say, God, I really want to grow, I really want to see the truth about myself, I really want to deal with this issue, and then someone comes along and goes, Deb, did you know this thing about you? And you go, ugh, no, I'm angry. Then your prayer wasn't real. It just wasn't. Yeah, yeah. Now, I realise sometimes we go, God, I'd really like to deal with this issue, you know, and I'd really like to see the truth about it. And then sometimes something comes along and you go, okay, thanks for that. Oh, actually, that's pretty full on now. I didn't think it was going to be that answer, or I didn't think it was going to be that thing. But how we respond in that moment, if we choose anger or rejection versus actually being humble to what it brings up, that shows the sincerity of our desire. Nothing else. It's how we respond in that moment. I don't care what you say to God in your private time. If when the law of attraction brings you something that highlights the issue and you reject it, you didn't really want it. That's logical, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, so, Jen had a hand up, yep. Thanks, Alex, for doing that.
For me, there's an issue of dependence. Receiving the gift, an excuse happens inside of me and I go into dependence upon you being the giver, me continuing to receive. It's a little different to expectation. It's more deeper than that. It becomes an issue of dependence.
So you want to be dependent on someone else?
Yeah, there's an
You want someone else to facilitate your growth for you?
Yeah, and it's an excuse.
Yeah, and under those circumstances, it doesn't feel that appealing to keep offering things because it actually begins to feel, and it is the truth of what's happening, I'm fostering something unhealthy in this person. If I love them, I'm not going to keep doing that. And if you think about what happened at the beginning of our talk today, that's exactly what AJ and I did. We said, no, Jen, can't help you with this one. There's an unloving feeling coming out of you, along with your desire to say thank you. Now, if we humour you to have you come and tell us your big thank you, but we can feel that you're already crowding us and we're in the middle of doing something else and we'd have to stop doing that thing in order for us to hear your thank you, it doesn't match. There's got to be an addiction in play. If we're really grateful, we don't need to pressure someone into hearing our thank you.
Thank you, Mary.
No worries. Okay. So can we see that for giving and receiving to occur, there has to be certain conditions. There has to be an open heart on the heart of the giver. And equally, for the gift to be received, there must be an openness on the part of the receiver. Yeah. Okay. This is some of the things that I feel have fallen down amongst this group. I feel that often we are giving when the heart is not open for whatever reason. And also there is an expectation that you receive without considering the addiction that's being fed through the reception or considering what you've done with the previous gifts. Now, I know that's probably a fairly confronting thing to say, but it is the truth of what I observe. And I'm not saying it's for all of you, but I am saying it's for many of you. And I'm saying that for me to be ethical, I feel that I need to be, unless I'm speaking to you about this issue, I need to be very reserved about presenting further truths. Because unless I'm addressing the issue of love that's in the dynamic right now, then I'm helping us avoid the issue of love in the dynamic. And that is actually an unloving thing. Okay. I had to write a list of everything that I wanted to cover because there was a lot I wanted to say. Okay. I'd like to talk now. I want to say briefly, but it might not be brief, about the gifts that you guys have been offered through divine truth, by divine truth. So it's just very tricky. It's my workout to actually get the board clean. Who has some ideas of what's been offered? And I say offered because, as I've just mentioned, they're not always received, are they? So what are the things being offered? Through divine truth, AJ, myself, the whole organisation. Jason, and then Alex. Or if we go Alex first and then Jason.
Just with truth and the giving of truth, just the opportunity to grow is just what... Spending that week down at Kentucky, the thing that I really came away with was the gratitude for the truth and the constant feedback that we received from you guys. And I was fortunate enough to be open to feeling a lot of the feedback that came toward me and us as a group.
Yep.
And how that really stayed with me and how appreciative I was of that. And
yeah. Okay. So in
the
brief,
opportunity to grow.
Personal truth,
yeah.
And the opportunity to grow. Okay, yeah. Okay, Jason. Thank you.
For me, it's actually a real path or pathway out of pain and suffering.
Sure. How so, do you mind saying? Like,
having been told about God and some truths, because I never knew about God or never contemplated, and how God, it's essential to be part of the healing process or progressive process. I never had that before, so now I feel it's real. And I needed some pretty big life wake-up calls to actually be open to God.
Yeah, okay, so the truth about God. And the truth about your soul is really what you're saying, isn't it?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. I had no awareness of my soul.
Yep.
And soulmates.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Jace. If you pass forward to Raj.
The opportunity to witness unconditional love in action.
So the opportunity to witness, yep, witness love in action. I always say this about unconditional love. All love is unconditional. So witness love in action. And I feel that's especially through AJ's example. I can't say I'm always perfect in that, but I see him act in a loving way consistently. Yeah. Yep. Okay, who else? If we go Dane and then over here to Jennifer.
A personal relationship with God.
Yes. So we're not giving you that, though, are we?
No. No, just the opportunity to develop it.
To develop it. And could you say some tools?
Yeah.
Tools to help you, yeah. In fact, I feel there's a lot of tools that have been given, yeah, to develop your own relationship with God. To be very honest with you guys, when I find like there's a lot of people around us saying, look, could you help me with this decision in my life? What do you think I should do right here? Could you tell me about this personal emotion? I've already mentioned that I feel it's about people avoiding developing their own relationship with God. But it also feels cultish. If I was going to be wandering around telling everyone exactly how to live their life and exactly what to do in every situation, and what are you doing in that relationship? You should be doing something else. That to me is a cult. And I want no part of it. Sometimes I feel there are people attracted who would like that, to avoid responsibility for our own actions. And we are never going to take away responsibility for your own actions because we just can't. God's given you responsibility for them and you can't give it back. You're always going to be responsible. Yeah. Okay. So, sorry, who's next? Yep. Peter H. Yep.
Well, I feel the divine truth is and what you're giving us is a detailed roadmap to change the destiny of our soul for all of eternity. To find that narrow path,
yep.
And not only to find it, but to learn how to walk on the path and to progress.
Because that's the thing, isn't it, Pete? There's a difference between learning it and walking it, isn't it?
Right.
And I feel that both things are offered here, the opportunity to learn and then the opportunity to understand what it means to walk it. Yeah.
Yep, and also to get feedback when you fall off your horse,
yeah,
to get back on and to keep going again.
Yeah, absolutely. Encouragement, feedback. Don't worry. I've been there. It's okay. You know, you can do this. Yeah.
So I mean, personally, I feel like it's the most awesome gift that anyone could be lucky enough to be given, and that's why I can't stop talking about it to everyone that comes across my path.
Yes.
Because, I mean, wow, imagine if I didn't say it and then they never actually found out.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I could have said it.
Yeah.
I could have actually pointed them in the direction that would eventually lead them to their soul becoming immortal. And yes. I didn't say it. Wow.
Wow. So, wow. And Pete, I do like really appreciate about you that you often share what you feel. It's what you feel is amazing about divine truth, and that you've actually taken initiative to stand up in front of people and talk about it many, many times. So, yeah, I feel, see, that to me is a reflection of your gratitude and the value you place on what you've heard. You've taken action on it in your life.
I don't feel like I could ever repay the gift fully. It's such a big gift.
Yeah, and I'm not up here talking about being repaid,
no,
you know?
No.
I don't feel like, the truth is I don't feel like payment is required. But when myself and AJ reach a situation where we realise on a number of fronts that we're not receiving enough donations to cover our expenses, that it seems like there's a lot of people around us stagnating in their progress, then this to us tells us it's not an issue about we're not getting paid enough. It's an issue about, hang on, there's lessons of love, gratitude and value that we're overlooking here with these people. And if we're loving, we'll address it. Yeah. Thanks, Pete.
Thank you.
Okay, if you pass forward. And who over here, if we go to Graham? Oh, sorry, Jennifer, had your hand up. If we go to Jennifer first. Yeah.
Okay. I was actually going to say what Dean said, which is developing a relationship with God, because that's been paramount for me on this path. But I'd also add, and this is related to the book group too, is a real sense of how to reflect, how to ask myself the questions and to be honest with myself. So yeah, the self-reflection's been a big part.
So again, it's about tools, isn't it? Okay, how am I going to develop humility? Self-reflection's going to have to be a part of it. Yep. Okay, Louise?
I feel what I've been offered is yours and AJ's honesty about all your feelings, every aspect of your life, and acting as a model for us with your growth.
Yeah, thank you, Louise. We're pretty transparent. Okay, Simon?
I feel the big one is to find happiness within ourselves. Yeah, true happiness, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so again, it's these tools to lasting happiness, to immortality, to developing a relationship with God. Yep. Okay, if we go to Tim, and then we can go to Ange as well.
Just with the God's way of love that's been set up, about how you guys and a lot of the team leaders are just basically facilitating everyone's desires, basically, and just helping them to learn about themselves and find that little spark inside that, you know, makes them want to live, basically, you know, that gets the excitement going.
That's been our desire with God's way of love, Tim, yeah, to create an opportunity where people have the capacity to explore their desires in a way that they'll receive feedback about the unlovingness within that, or how to actually practice love in action when we're working together. Sadly, I don't know if everyone has received that gift either, and AJ and I will be talking about that in the next half, yeah. But it's lovely to hear that you feel that. Okay, if we go to Ange, and...
Mary, I was just going to say that you guys just didn't write a book about this. You have said it again and again and again in so many different ways. So you've honoured us, you know, where we were at the time and every step along the way. So it's, it's an offering, you know, from your hearts that is specifically for us. You know, at this time, it's catered for us, and that's a true gift. You know, that's a huge dimension to it all.
Yeah, thanks, Ant. We have a big desire to meet people where they're at, definitely. Graham, and we nearly need to move on. And
for me, it's there's a practical aspect, like a roadmap and all that stuff. It's theory.
Yes, good. Well, I want to move on to the practicalities. Yes.
Like there's, to me, it feels like there's signposts and guideposts that you can actually use when you're actually walking the path, you know. You know, little give us hints so that we know when we're starting to fall off the track, you know. And and stuff like that, but it's stuff that we actually use while we're actually doing it rather than just sitting in a classroom learning stuff. You know?
Yeah, there's practical feedback, isn't there?
Yeah.
Like, you know, Jen coming up to us going, now, Jen, that's that lesson we've... I'm sorry to point you out, just a very recent example, but that's that thing we've talked to you about, and here it is in action. It's a practical feedback mechanism, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, if we just come forward. Yep.
What I think the most one of the most important things for me has been to look at integrity and how the benchmark for integrity was so much higher than I ever thought it would be.
Yeah. So look, can we all agree there's some pretty comprehensive information, spiritually speaking? We've had the opportunity to learn about what it means to be ethical, God's feelings about love, God's feelings about creation, how God desires for us to live, our potentials, all of these things. Now let's think practically. What is physically offered to you? Barbara?
Sorry, that's what I'd been trying to get to, because all of those things are given. It's the time, your time, your friendship, the love, all of those things, but your time, the practical things that you do for every talk, every seminar, every interview, the people involved in all of that, it's all offered for
free. So let's list them. Seminars.
Yep.
Interviews.
Interviews.
Interviews, yep.
Mediumship.
Mediumship.
Clubs, workshops,
yep,
whatever.
Workshops, groups, etc. Hey. So there's actually practically a lot of things that are going on that you have the opportunity to be in person at. Now, what happens when you're in person? What's provided when you're in person? Jennifer? Jen, actually. Jen, just there, Alex, here.
Each time you address a question to anyone in the audience, there's not only information, there's an incredible open-heartedness and acceptance and love coming from you and AJ
every single time. Jen, let's talk about the fact that you're sitting in a seat. So there's a seat available, isn't there? We've mentioned a lot of this attitude and stuff, but okay. Hey, Anna?
We get to be in a comfy room, and we get to share, like, we also get to meet people with the similar interests, which is awesome.
Yeah.
I really like that.
Yeah. That is one of the coolest things you told me when you found Divine Truth, wasn't it? I remember you told me a long time ago, it's like, all these people who love God as much as me or want God as much as me.
I've forgotten that. Awesome. Oh, thanks.
So a comfortable seat and a comfortable environment. What other physical things are provided to you? Ange? Sorry if I'm missing people.
We get the use of microphones so we can all hear. We have people who serve us with the microphones. We have camera people. We have...
Exactly. We have it all recorded. We have sound. Yeah. We have a lot of consistent volunteers who do these things for you. And they're the same people pretty much, even down to people who handle the microphones. Very often it's the same few people who do that every single time. So you are, what I said in book group is you are served. There is so much service happening around you. And what happens in the break? Cool vegan food, like, and it's all laid on, really, isn't it? It's all here at your fingertips, and all you have to do is park your car outside. It's not even tricky parking, and here you are, and it's all systems go. You can walk in at 5 to 1, and people have been here since 11 a.m. sorting all that out for you. You can leave at 5 o'clock, and the people stay on for another hour and a half sorting it out again, so it's ready for you the next morning. So there's a lot of things that are provided, isn't there? Beyond what happens in person, what else happens? Louise?
A lot of us have got a lot of personal feedback, and today we're getting group feedback. That's really helpful. And
yes.
Also, it's my understanding that you and AJ spend a lot of your money on stuff for us, Like, you know, I've heard AJ say you've bought the latest equipment on mics and stuff.
Yeah, yeah, we take seriously making sure that what we're producing is of a good quality for people. So we purchase a lot of sound and video, or we have purchased a lot of sound and video equipment. I think my mate tells me we're nearly right now. We don't need to get any more, but we'll see. And computers for Lena and Igor to work on. And there's huge backup system that happens so that no data is lost. If the internet fails or a DVD is scratched, I can guarantee you there's at least two or three other sources of finding that information again. So there's a lot of time and effort going into making sure this information is available to a lot of people in an easy way. Now there's booklets, there's transcripts, there's a team of people working on transcribing all of the talks, providing diagrams of, hopefully they never have to do this one, but, you know, diagrams of what's written on the board. And Raj and Suzanne have just gone through a process of making little booklets that you can give out, and it's a summary. It's all very neatly formatted and edited, so there's no ums and ahs and does that make senses in there. It's just a little booklet for you to read to discover the secrets of the universe. And what I find is very few people really even consider where it all comes from and how much goes into it and how much of a service it actually is. I was talking to Raj before we started, and he was saying him and Suze are really excited about this project, and so am I, because we have just been contacted by a group in Kenya who really want to translate this material into 5 local African languages. And because we have this stuff already done, we can send it to them as a document. They can get it translated, and there is divine truth for them. They hardly have a 14 watt solar system or generator to run this tight, like, vintage retro little black and white telly. That's their access to technology so far. They have to drive to Nairobi to use the internet. You know, they live out in the sticks. But because this work has been done, within the next month, they can have divine truth translated into 5 local languages. It's pretty special, isn't it? Yeah. And I must say, that's not just based on what Raj has and Suze have done. It's the team that Barbara has been leading for how many years now, Barb? 3 years, leading transcription. So that their goal is for every talk that AJ's ever given to be transcribed and made into some format that's readily available to people. The pageant messages have been translated into Spanish. Like, there's a lot of work that's going on behind the scenes that is very little thought of. Yeah. And Raj was saying beforehand that he has people going, oh, that's really great. Could you just give me 6 copies of that and I'll give it to my mates? And he says, yeah, I'd love to do that. But hang on, actually, that's going to cost me quite a lot of money. And everyone, it seems, or many people, it seems, are in this mindset of, it's all for free, so I'll just take it and give it out. And there's no thought to his personal resources that are going into creating this gift for others. Now, you could say, he should tell you, it costs me $2.50 to make every one of these booklets. And then we'd know what to give him. But my question for you is, like, why didn't you think of that? Someone's giving you a golden gift, like, it's amazing, and nobody's even considering where that came from. And this is really the feeling that I'm trying to address on a larger scale with divine truth as it exists at the moment. Okay, let's move on. I'm just going to run through some more of the physical things. We've said a clean venue, a comfortable seat, video and audio files, books and written transcripts. And if you think about the website, what an incredible resource that's just maintained by AJ himself of so many audio files. There's books you can download, there's mediumship. There is so much there on offer. Okay, the office emails that Luli really helps us out with. Anyone new coming along or anyone who has a question about an upcoming seminar can email that address and they get a prompt and I think fairly impressive response most of the time. Yeah, that she spends a lot of time doing that. So there is all these things happening behind the scenes. Okay, now I'm just going to run through some of the statistics of what usually happens at a seminar, just at a seminar now. So I'm not talking about all of this stuff, I'm talking at a single seminar, and what's reflected in the donations. So, the average seminar is 4 hours in duration. The average seminar involves 8 hours of time for people involved to set up and dismantle. So they're here early, they're leaving later, and that's how much time it takes. And the average seminar in this local area is about 150 people. I reckon that's about how many here today? Yep. Okay. The average donations in total for a 4-hour seminar is this a 4-hour or an 8-hour? I've got 4-hour here, but it's $1,500 for the single day. The average donation per person, therefore, is $2.50 per hour, or $10 for the 4 hours. Now, given what we've just talked about, what is provided, that seems like that either the feeling amongst people is that it's not very valuable, or that there's no... Well, it really, that's what it seems to indicate, that there's an expectation that I'm able to receive this, and there's no sense of real gratitude. I feel that some of you don't donate at all, and some of you do donate more, and often it's because you feel the gratitude for what's been presented. It's made an impact on your life, and so you feel like you want to give more as a result. Okay. The next statistic I have is an average of 1/2 of people in attendance actually donate, and that is not something that we usually keep track of, but as we were realising that this is an issue, we just did a one-off count of the donation box here and a one-off count of the donation box at Book Group by literally counting the number of notes. And by that count, there is a maximum of 1/2 of the audience that give at a seminar and 1/3 at Book Group. Okay. An average of 5% of people watching YouTube on Divine Truth videos actually donate, and that's based on the donations we receive over the internet versus the number of people who subscribe and the number of viewings on YouTube. And an average of 1% of people coming to the website actually donate anything. Okay, moving on, the average seminar costs. So what we receive generally for a 4-hour seminar is $1,500. This is what we expend in order to present the seminar. The hall hire ranges, depending on where we are, from $100 to $450 a day. The vehicle hire, the van actually, well, if we say the vehicle, the van costs us $200 a week because we're paying that off. And we purchased the van so that we could fit all the equipment in. The sound, video, lighting, computer, hard disks, RAID drives, all of those costs average out to $1,000 per week in depreciation alone, and that's from our tax figures. So the average cost of a seminar, if it was held every week, would be $1,400 a week. So in that calculation, we haven't calculated anything for people's time. We haven't calculated for our own personal time or the time of all the volunteers who donate their time. We're just looking at the physical expenses. So if we receive $1,500 and our outgoing is $1,400, there's $100 to play with in order to support myself and AJ and give to Lena and Igor, who support us by full-time working on the videos. And also the other people who are regularly here, like Yvonne and Vlad, are very consistent in their assistance of us. Okay. Yep. I'm just conscious of the time, so I'm just... how are we doing? Okay. Yeah, so I've talked about the four main people involved in the delivery of Divine Truth so far. It's myself, Jesus, Lena and Igor. We're the people who full-time work on this. So if we average that out amongst the four people, the average attendee, based on that figure of $10 for 4 hours, values our time at 60 cents per hour. And if we added the two other people, Yvonne and Vlad, these six people, the average attendee values their time, at each of us individually, at 42 cents per hour. Yvonne and Vlad are yet to actually receive any donations from us or others. And there are many other people, as I've mentioned, who donate to sort out the meals, to handle your microphones, and to clean up the venue afterwards. And consistently, as I mentioned, these are the same people each time. Okay. So that's what goes into presenting a seminar. What's not included in all of those figures is the time editing and producing the videos, which is actually takes at least twice the amount of time that I actually speak. It will take Lena and Igor to edit the videos. Producing and cataloguing the DVDs, and Yvonne has helped us out with cataloguing the DVDs, so there's masters of all the DVDs, and the ordering and copying of DVDs that we used to give out here. It doesn't include the preparation time myself and AJ spend before a presentation. It doesn't include the transcription work that Barbara and Lizzie and Luli have been doing consistently. It doesn't include uploading the material to YouTube, which Teresa in Armidale does for us, and then AJ needs to log into YouTube and tag it all so it's all searchable, all very neatly arranged and easy to find things. It doesn't include the making of master hard drives or hard disk drives for copying for everyone, because we want to provide those things so that people can have a hard disk drive of everything that we've ever presented. And it doesn't account for other copying that we do. So the USB, making the masters for things that we do. Okay. So myself and AJ just wrote some comments about that situation. And some of them I've already covered. Just based on that, and as I've said, that the way that we show value is not just through money. But you can't deny that it's a reflection. If the average attendee would spend more on a cup of coffee at the coffee shop than they would on listening, a cup of coffee and a piece of cake, than they would on listening to 4 hours of Divine Truth material, which you guys just told me is like the most awesome thing ever in the world. Now, unless none of you ever go to coffee shops and drink tea, coffee, or cake, you know, there's something where your words are not matching your actions. And also, as I mentioned earlier, when we really value something, it's not only shown in our donations, but it's shown in our lives. And this is something that we're addressing with you guys now. The other thing that I mentioned in Book Group was that if it wasn't for the generous donations of around 8 different families, we would have been having this discussion a lot sooner, because there's no way we would have survived at all. You know, 8 different people last year gave us substantial donations, and that's how we could produce so many interviews and put them on YouTube. That's how we could travel. That's how we could present Divine Truth to new people as well as to yourselves. It's how we've helped to support Lena and Igor. All of these things have happened because 8 people or 8 families felt that they wanted to support this mission that we're on. Yeah. We're also now completely open about our finances. You can view our tax records online, and we plan to make that a regular thing. It's on the Divine Truth website, has been for a few weeks. So if you want to see how we're spending our money, it's all laid out there for you. Basically, 90% of what we receive in donations goes back towards presenting more Divine Truth. We're pretty happy with that statistic, actually. Some people, tithing is usually 10% of your income goes towards a spiritual or a church or something. We feel like 90% is, we don't need that much to live on in our day-to-day lives. But if we can use what we have, 90% of what we have to support our passion in sharing this truth, then yeah, we don't want to change that. Okay. And the last comment that we wanted to make was we could do a lot more worldwide if the average person was more appreciative. And that goes not just in the monetary sense, but think what would happen worldwide if 150 people really received the truth and went, I'm acting on that. So far, as I said, one person in the audience has decided to teach divine truth to others. I know there's three others who decided, but nobody showed up. So obviously there's some issues to work through there around what's happening with my desire. Is it pure? But one person so far has shared divine truth with everyone who crosses his path. Imagine if we were living examples of this truth. What would happen worldwide? AJ has often said, it's not going to be him who talks to every single person on the planet, who changes the planet. You know, it's impossible. There has to be, what I feel about divine truth is it's a set of teachings. This is a set of teachings that give you all of those opportunities that we talked about earlier that I wrote on the board. That's my life's purpose, is to share these teachings and to have people do with it what they want. And that's why I said at the start, it's okay if you don't want to be here. I'm not invested in you listening right now to what I'm saying. But if you have a desire to, if you want to, then let's talk about it, because it's really exciting stuff. But it's not a destination. It's not a destination for me, and it's not a destination for you. It's a set of teachings that help me move forward. I see a lot of you kind of come, right, we've come to this area, we're here for the talks, there's some God's Way of Love stuff going on. And it's like a destination. You're waiting for AJ and I to tell you what to do next. And I'm not going to tell you. I'm just going to keep talking to you about humility, truth, and love. Because my desire is to teach you about. It's not to help you find your desire, to execute it. You know, we're all unique souls. I feel the expression of your personality in your life, given the tools that the teachings give you, would make for a very rich world, a very rich world. But it's not going to look the same for everyone. And it's not going to happen if we're all just sitting out here going, right, we're here, we're up for the talk, we're here ready for the talks whenever they happen, and I don't really know what to do next. I don't have a job, or I'm not really doing anything that really excites me. Now, those two things, if I'm a person who's listened to divine truth for 4 years and I don't have a job, I can't support myself, or I'm not doing anything that excites me, then I've missed like really huge amounts of the teachings. I've missed what it means to take personal responsibility. I could tell you a talk you could watch if you'd like to learn about that. There's one called Taking Personal Responsibility. We've missed issues of love of ourselves, love of our others, the nature of our soul, how God works with desire. God works with desire. Nothing else. You can't grow if you don't have desire. So that's what I'm trying to shake up here today, is that it feels stagnant, it feels flat, it feels like we're in a repeating cycle, and that's not what I'm trying to teach about. Yeah, okay. All right. Whew, I have a lot to say. This happened last time. Okay. I just wanted to address a couple of things and then I'll finish. What is the time? Is it okay? That's fine. I don't know if I can fit it all into a quarter of an hour, but I'll give it my best shot. Okay. So, I had a question from someone who listened to the talk last week. Firstly, does anyone have any questions based on what I've been saying? Yeah, Amber at the back. Yeah, thank you.
Hi, Mary.
Hi.
I was just wondering if you guys had worked out a price of what we could donate that would actually cover everything.
No. And we don't plan to. Because that would be giving you a price tag, wouldn't it?
Yeah, but I don't know. I think it
How
might
do we
help.
Put a price tag on the tools that help you develop a relationship with God?
I don't know. That just went over my head. What was the question? Sorry.
How do I put a price tag on the tools that I might teach that help you develop a relationship with God?
Yeah. But just on a practical level, like money-wise, what would cover all the costs? Like, have you calculated?
Well, I just told you how much it costs in our physical outgoing expenses to present a seminar. However,
yep.
This is where I feel a lot of people go, and this is where people went the first time we tried to talk about it and the second time. They went, okay, these guys need a hall. We should just like figure out a hall and do that for them. Or, you know, we'll just pay for Lena and Igor's internet costs. Or we'll, and everyone is really used to, right, it's about dollars, it's about outgoing, incoming, all of this, we'll just cover it and they'll be right.
Yeah, that's sort of how I feel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's probably how a lot of people feel, Amber.
Yeah.
But I feel that's missing the deeper lesson, which is about value. How much do you value what you receive and the level of gratitude you have? Now, for myself and AJ, there is an issue of incoming, outgoing. That is, if we don't receive enough to cover our expenses, we must stop. This is an ethical choice that I spoke about last time I spoke about this. It means I'm going to have to rely on someone else to provide my passion in order to support me doing my passion. Now, that is not ethical. If I'm relying on the government to support me to do my passion, not ethical. If I'm relying on my partner to supply the abundance for me to do my passion, not ethical. I'm not looking at what the law of attraction is telling me in that moment. The law of attraction in that moment is telling me, hey, girl, there's something wrong with this desire. You're going to have to face something. You're going to have to address something. You're going to have to look at what's really going on here. Now, that's what the situation is for us. If we don't receive enough, okay, we're going to have to get a job. We're cool with that. We're going to... Do you disagree, babe? Are you shaking your head? Yeah. However... What I want to say more to Amber about the issue of value, but go ahead on that point.
Oh, there's so much I'd like to say about it.
Well, there's a lot I want to say to Amber about value.
Yeah, but I'm thinking too, though, that you're skipping over an issue with Amber, and that is the issue that she wants a figure, and the reason why she wants a figure. And the reason why she wants a figure is that she doesn't want to have to work it out for herself how much she's grateful. She doesn't want to work out for herself how much she values it. So she wants you to tell her how much she should value it. The other thing too, and I feel any other comment made to her is really pointless in a way, because yep. She basically wants to know what value, where she wants us to tell her what value she should place on it.
That's what I was going to say.
And,
yeah.
And I just can't agree with that, really. The other thing is that the reality is many of you do not trust us yet. Like, if you trusted us, you'd realise that we use your funds probably far better than what many of you use your own funds, actually, in terms of the distribution of divine truth on the planet. And the reality is that myself and Mary live on just under $17,000 a year. That's our collective, what we live on. And the rest of the money that we receive goes towards doing what we do. Now, if somebody gave me $1 million, then I'd have more money to spend on doing what we do. And to be honest with you, it's not about what we need. What I feel it's about is, what do you want? Do you want divine truth to be worldwide? Do you want divine truth to be known by every person on this planet? Is that what you want?
What I said to the group last week is most of them don't.
No,
they want local Jesus that they can come to. They get a nice seat. It's very comfortable, pleasant, personal access, can ask you a few personal questions.
Yeah, because if there's more people, there's less time for you, right? Yeah,
and so. When we went to Greece, that's exactly what happened. We went to Greece, the guys in Greece very, well... They paid for us to come. They donated money for us to come. Then everyone in Europe came and they got really shirty about it. They were like, hey, You are for us.
We paid for you to come.
We paid for you to come, so you should... It's not enough you're giving seminars. We should have one-on-one time with you.
Yeah. And the reality also is that if we are truly sincere about sharing divine truth with others, many of us would already... if I had a list of all the people who said to me, I realise that it's my passion, that what you're teaching is something I realise that's my life's purpose to share that with the world, and yet when I've observed them over the following 4 years, almost every single person that said that to me hasn't shared anything. And that tells me what a bit of the problem is. Why are you so afraid about sharing the truth to other people? And fear and also some selfishness involved about, you know, I know the truth, I want to prevent other people from knowing the truth. If I took that stance with everybody, then none of you would have heard it. And to be frank, nobody would have heard it in the first century either. Nobody would have heard it in the spirit world, and I'd be a lone celestial spirit if you could ever reach that state by not sharing.
You couldn't.
Which you can't, of course. So the reality, I feel, is that we can discuss a lot of issues about why this and why that, but in the end, it really gets down to how do you personally value it? Like, how do you demonstrate in your life that you personally value it? And why do you want us, myself and Mary, to provide, you know, proof or evidence or figures to you about your own value? Like I know when I value something, I don't come and ask you what I'm going to give you. Like, I don't ever go and ask Lena and Igor, what do you want? Like, I know what they need already. I've got a life.
And we know what it means to us, what they're giving.
Yeah, and I also from a practical level, know that the average person who's on unemployment in this country, if they're a couple, get around in the $30,000 per annum. Now, Mary and I live on much less than that, but I know that if Lena and Igor are going to comfortably live, we need to give them at least 36 grand a year. That I know that, because that's what pretty much everybody needs if they're going to have a life, particularly if they're doing what they're doing, travelling around with us and so forth. I know that. I don't need to ask them. And so all I do is tell them how much they're going to invoice me every month. Like, and if I've got the funds available to donate those things and I have a desire, I do that without asking them. So why do you need to ask us? Like, I don't feel anybody needs to ask us at all. I feel what we need to do instead is ask ourselves, well, do we really appreciate divine truth? Do we really want some of these things to continue? Because if you don't, Mary and I are completely happy to stop. We don't need divine truth.
We don't need...
Do you understand that? We don't need it because we've already found it. We remember it.
Yeah. That's right. We don't need a teaching of divine truth. We got it. You know? So I'm actually really desirous to spend some time at home with my soulmate. This year alone, we've been home 2 months. And I'd like to just hang out with him in the eco tent. So, but I mean, obviously I like talking about divine truth as well. But I'm okay. And this is what I said to the book group. I'm totally okay. I'm totally okay to stop doing what we do. In fact, for me personally, I'm rethinking everything that we do. Like, how is it I want to express and share divine truth? Like, because what we've been doing, it doesn't seem that effective. I'm not witnessing, like, hugely changed lives. There must be a way that I can do this differently because I don't want to breed addiction in people who listen. Yeah. Okay. I realise it's not my responsibility if people want to enter addiction, but I can act in a way that is self-reflective myself at what I'm attracting around me. And I'm well aware that I'm refining my desire as well. I'm refining the way that I'm able to present things, and that will affect what is attracted to us, which is exciting. This is the exciting thing about the teachings, hey? You know, you act, you get the truth back at you, you go, oh, okay, that hurts. Right, let's feel it, let's act again. Right, what's being shown to me now? This is the magic of the path. This is what you don't get to experience if you just sit and listen and go, that sounds really good, but I'm afraid or I'm in lack or whatever. It requires an action in faith in order to really come to experience the path. Okay. Did you want to add anything more about that, baby? Okay. I want to just address one question that I received from someone who listened last week. And that was, how can we say it's free and then talk about donations? Did anyone else feel that? Yeah? So what does that question... That question says to me, this person feels that somehow I'm manipulating things by speaking about the truth of what's happening. Jason?
I can just feel that person has missed the spirit of the relationship between donation and what you do. It's not that you have to donate. You're not saying to donate. Yeah. It's just that if there's an appreciation that you just feel excited, oh, I just feel like they give you something. Like children do it all the time. Like they just... You're just doing the dishes and then minding your own business. Then the child comes up and goes, oh, I just feel to give you this flower I made. And you didn't ask for it. It's just a gift that they just... And that's the natural essence of who we are.
Yeah.
We just love to give, but we've lost it.
Yeah, well, when we're not naturally giving, then there's an issue that we're taking. Yeah, exactly. Anyway, my answer to this person was that I can very easily talk about donations and still be offering something for free. And that's because, one, I'm just speaking factually. I'm not in some manipulative dynamic with you. I'm not saying if you don't donate to me, that's it, I'll never talk to you again. I'm not saying if you don't donate to me, you are going to hell. If you don't donate to me, you know, I'm not saying any of that stuff. I'm just saying, hey, nobody's donating. It's showing there's an issue of love here. It's an issue that we're looking at. I'm stopping doing some of the stuff that I've been doing, and I'm giving you the opportunity to be aware about why this is happening. The second reason why I feel it's okay to talk about this, it goes to what Jason said. I feel that this is a lesson of love relating to value or gratitude, not money. So I feel it's okay to speak about donations. What I find interesting about this is, we are very open and transparent that the way we support our teaching of divine truth is via donations. You all see a donation box at the back of the hall. You all see a how to donate tab on our website. You all know this. And it goes on silently. And then, if we mention it, aha, this is unloving. Why? It's happening. Why can't I just talk about the truth of what's happening? If I mention the truth, I'm somehow less honest or less humble. No, that's not good logic to me. I agree that if I was manipulating you in some way into making a donation, okay, that would be a different story or scenario. But I know that I'm not doing that. Yeah. Okay. But I do think that it does indicate... This is my illustration of how big I feel most people want divine truth to stay. And if we cover our costs, that's how big it will stay. It can grow exponentially if people embrace it and embrace the sense of gratitude. Anyway, back to the question about talking about donations. I just want to briefly run through some false beliefs that I observe around us surrounding one, Jesus. Two, God-reliant. And three, abundance. I feel that the question and the comment from the person that I received, and again, you know, I don't think this person is alone in their feelings, they just happen to write them to me, indicates not only that they don't really have a sense of gratitude, they have a feeling of expectation, and probably a fear of being manipulated. But I also feel this feeling is common because people have a viewpoint of Jesus that has been ingrained into us since, I don't know, Christmas stories when you were three or something. What is the stereotypical image you have of Jesus? And?
I guess a bit of a peasant.
Yes, a peasant who wanders the land just with no need for anything, speaking truth with hardly the clothes on his back. Is this not the common image we have of Jesus? And what else is inherent in that? That Jesus shouldn't give a care for his personal needs or his personal happiness, because he's just love and he just gives and he loves being poor and it's all okay. And, you know, the feeling I had... someone told me that... someone wrote and said, you know, why would I stop giving book group if I didn't have enough donations? Because isn't it my passion? Which overlooks the issue of ethics, obviously. But the feeling I had was that we should mortgage our home and live on the streets so that we can just give divine truth to others. You know, this is skipping over so many lessons of love and personal responsibility that we've spoken about previously. But I do feel there's a lot of stuff in a lot of people about how Jesus would act. My Jesus is like this, you know. And we have this idea that love means poverty, don't we? A lot of people do. A lot of people have a feeling that rich people are actually evil. That they're corrupt, they shouldn't be trusted, they're takers. That the rich people are takers. And yet I see a lot of very poor people in a lot of taking kind of mentality. So this is another false belief, I feel, that means that when we mention the issue of money, people freak out. It triggers so many different things inside of us. If somebody gave us $1 million tomorrow, how would you all feel then? What? $1 million? Jesus got $1 million. What? Is he going to start driving like a, I don't know, what's an expensive car? Yeah, I don't know, a Ferrari? Jesus wouldn't drive a Ferrari. Yeah, that kind of feeling, if you can you feel that feeling in you? Yeah, you had your hand up, Jane.
With a personalised number plate.
With Jesus. A personalised, yeah. G. G. S-U-S, yeah. Jason.
I've noticed, because I drive a bus for Endeavour Foundation with Disabilities, but I've noticed a lot of people in seemingly doing good work for others, their soul condition or their personal lives are generally in worse condition than the people they're trying to help or support.
Yes.
And it's actually killing them.
Yes.
So there's a huge emotional error where a lot of people are trying to do good, but it's causing them so much pain that they're in denial of.
Exactly, which indicates, doesn't it, that their desire is not pure, they're in addiction. Now, when we love, we do serve. There's no question. When we love, we do give most of what we have away. We give away 90% of what we receive. But it doesn't mean we live on the street like a pauper. It doesn't mean we neglect care and respect for our time and ourselves. This is a false belief that is very, very common. Other false beliefs I listed about Jesus. Jesus should help me every time I demand it from him. Because he's Jesus after all, you know. So many people have prayed to him and he's there, you know, he's going to be there when I demand it. Jesus would never challenge me emotionally by being direct. A lot of people have that feeling. He can't be Jesus. When I'm around him, it doesn't feel that comfy. You know, it should just be like radiating love and we just bask in it. And, you know, a lot of people have that feeling. Yeah, so Jesus would always make me feel good about myself. Jesus should be poor. He should give everything to others without restraint. Now, there's a difference between just giving from our heart and giving to people who want to receive, to giving without restraint, isn't there? Yeah. Okay. That another false belief that has come across our inbox as well. Jesus has dealt with his money issues, so I shouldn't give to him. We thought you dealt with your money issues. I stopped donating to you ages ago. It's a little bit of magical thinking, isn't it? Like, oh, well, he'll just magically get money. And it also overlooks this issue that AJ was just talking about. Jesus, AJ, it's all confusing. Jesus was talking about the fact that a person is not feeling, what do I feel about this gift? Do I value it? How would I express my gratitude? Just thinking, well, he can pay his bills, he'll be right. It's very different things. Yeah, the next thing I wrote was Jesus can make money magically appear from heaven. Jesus is closest to God, so God will give him what we need, what he needs without me having to help. Now, a lot of people have that feeling. It's your mission, mate. You're going to save the world. Good luck with that. I'm back here. This is stuff that I feel in my day-to-day life, living with Jesus and interacting with people who are around us and in the world. These kind of feelings, you know. He's the man with the mission. He's going to do it all. And I don't actually have to do much. Now, it's not going to work out like that. And you're actually not going to grow your own soul anyway by just sitting back and letting everyone do anything. Be it redemption of the world or, you know, building a four-story home, whatever. If you sit back and go, I'm really interested in that, I think it's a really good idea, but I'll let other people do it, you miss out on so much. Okay. False beliefs about God reliance. Because a lot of people also feel, well, what, they're talking about donations? That's not being God reliant. My question is, why not? Can anyone remember the definition of God reliance I used in the opening to God workshops? That's going back away. Who can remember? Who can have a stab? Oh, Paul, you can remember.
Follow your desires.
Yes, first up, wasn't it? Follow your desires. Then what?
Be open to them being in truth or not.
Yes, be open to the feedback mechanism, which is the law of attraction, to show you what's truth and what's error. Then what? What would you do, Paul?
Humility.
Yes.
Be humble.
Yes, so be humble to
the law of attraction and yes. Where it leads you.
Be humble to the law of attraction, exactly, and recognise that if I'm in pain, then there's some kind of error in my desire. Perfect. Then what would you do after that? And?
Oh, act.
Act.
Yeah. Came from me. And...
Keep going. Yeah. This is my desire. This is where I'm headed. Yeah. Well done, Paul, by the way. Awesome. This is my desire. I'm going for it. If the law of attraction shows me something that is painful, then I'll deal with it. I'll learn the lesson of love, knowing that that's purifying my desire, and I'll keep going. And I'll be ready for the next feedback mechanism, the next lesson in love. Now, a lot of you feel that God reliance means, because of that, God reliance means that I should continue allowing unloving treatment towards myself. Just feel about it, shut up about it, and keep on going. Now, what if the lesson of love is something that's showing me, hey, you're ignoring. You're ignoring how people are taking what you give for granted. What would the lesson of love be then? Like, how would I act to correct myself? Wouldn't I change, feel whatever pain I had associated with that? But wouldn't my actions change? Wouldn't my words change? Wouldn't I actually confront the unloving dynamic that I feel is going on? I'd still be in God reliance because I'm learning the lesson of love and I'm purifying my desire as I go. Does everyone see that? A lot of people are lost on that one. No? Questions? Do you know what I'm saying? No? Okay. So let's just be really specific about this example. I've had people say that I'm not being God reliant because I spoke to book group about the donations not covering the expenses. So the false belief is obviously that if I was God-reliant, then I would just either keep doing book group and ignore, because God should provide, it's my law of attraction, so, you know, God should just provide for me and I shouldn't actually have to talk to the people I'm engaged with about it. That's really the underlying message, isn't it? That there's a problem with me talking about it. But I'm saying to you, what if the lesson of love is, hey, Mary, you've got a huge amount of fear addressing issues of money. You've got a huge amount of issues around your own personal worth, and you're actually in dynamics where you want people to not value you. You're actually going to have to speak up, girl, about money and honour your own worth. Now, wouldn't I still be in God reliance if I did that? Yeah. So the false belief many people have about God reliance is that you just endure bad stuff and feel about it, and it will magically change. And I'm saying to you, if you're in a situation, let's take it to another extreme. If you're in an abusive situation, if you're being beaten by your husband, and you get beaten, you just feel about it, and hopefully hope that the situation will change, it's not likely to change, is it? You are going to have to, and in fact, if you truly felt about it, if you really, like, if you really looked at your emotions around it and learnt the lesson of love, you would be saying something about it, and you would be acting to correct it. You would say, you can't hit me anymore, and I'm leaving. Now, that is an example of God reliance. It's learning the lesson that God is showing and continuing in action. So there's a lot of false beliefs I feel people have around what is God reliant anyway. Jason?
I know for myself, and I think it's probably a common world belief, that feeling that God reliant is you put the prayer out to God and God will do it for you. Not
yes.
Realising that we're all meant to be acting in harmony with God's truth. So then God reliance is demonstrated through people around you who feel the same way or have that desire. So
very much. Yeah, very much,
and,
Jason.
And then I've been caught where, well, God reliance means I just sit around, don't do nothing, waiting for God to, like, do the thing.
God do the thing. No, one of the things I used to say when I talked about it in the Opening to God workshops is that I love that God is requiring our engagement in this God reliance. He's saying, unless you engage with me, we can't have an interaction. And unless you take responsibility for what's being shown to you, you can't grow anymore. So in a way, he's helping us to know ourselves so well in this process of growing towards him. That's a pretty awesome parent with a desire that you know and love yourself while you come to receive their love. Yeah, very beautiful process. Yeah. Gus?
Hey, I think you hit the nail on the head when you the speaking up bit, because like God said, I sent you a whole lot of people to your book group so you can get the message out, and you know, you've just been sitting there not speaking up, like, it'd be good to get some money. So a lot of people just...
Sorry, what did you say? It'd be good to get some money?
Yeah, it's good to get some money donations.
Yeah.
So, you're speaking up. And if you don't speak up, like, with that situation, any other situation, then, you know, God sends you these people or whatever. But if you don't speak up and say your piece, nobody knows. You know, like being abused or anything like that. If nobody speaks up, then nobody knows. So you've got to speak up.
Yeah, yep. You've got to speak up. It gives people the chance to be aware, doesn't it?
Exactly, and,
yeah.
Otherwise, people might just go along thinking, oh, well, it'll be right.
It'll be right. Yeah. But as we mentioned, there's an issue with that, isn't there? Where we're just like, oh, it'll be right. I don't have to think about anything. We've kind of skipped over a lot of lessons of self-reflection.
A lot of people go through a whole lifetime without speaking up and get nowhere.
Yeah, that's very true, Gus. Yeah. AJ?
Yeah, I was just thinking from my own summary of this subject. No, I'm happy to stay here. I just feel like I'd be very, very happy if every single person in attendance, instead of donating to me, used their money that they would normally donate to me to spread divine truth. Like, I'd be very, very happy with that outcome.
Yeah.
And, like, if that meant you and I having to get a part-time job because we need to get a part-time job, I feel that 150 people spreading divine truth, you can't put the price on that. You know, you can't pay for that.
Yeah.
Because that's a lot of people's effort and time spreading the truth to other people. I do feel that a coordinated effort, obviously, would be better than an uncoordinated one.
Yeah.
But I feel the main point that we want to make is that if you don't feel like you want to donate to us to help spread divine truth, then my suggestion is, if you don't trust us yet or whatever it is that you feel that causes you to feel that way, that's fine. But my suggestion is, instead, use the money you would donate to us if you did trust us in your own life spreading divine truth.
Yeah.
Like, do that. At least do that. If you really appreciate the truth you're receiving, at least do that.
Oh, that would just make my year. That would just be such a beautiful, like, I would almost feel like that's a gift. That's more than I can do alone. If 150 people went out there and went, this is an amazing life-changing truth, they lived their life in accordance with it and they shared it in whatever way they could, that to me is just the most beautiful thing. Like, the only thing more beautiful is 200 people doing it, or 250, or do you know? It would just be the most heart-moving thing that I could think of, and perhaps that's a good place to finish. You know, that we talked a lot about value and about the issues and the addictions and everything that I feel is stuff to look at here in this dynamic, especially in this local area. But if each of you, if half of you, if you don't feel like donating to us, it is really okay. It is really okay. We are both really content to re-enter the workforce, you know? Not sure exactly what jobs we would do, but and who would employ us, but, you know, I've done a lot of different jobs in my life, from, like, cleaning toilets to, you know, professionally working in institutions and everything in between, and I'm really comfortable doing any of those things again, although probably they'd want to admit me rather than employ me in places where I used to work. yeah, but if you guys do feel value for what you receive, it is not obligatory to put money in our donation box. If you value it, then can I inspire you to do something with it? To do something with it. That would be just make our day. Yeah. Okay, thanks, guys. I'm going to invite Lena and Igor now to come up. They've felt that they would like to say some things. The last time they spoke at the end of book group, and they found out it was a little bit more challenging than what they thought when you stand up in front of all the people. So, yeah, if you take Alex's. Thanks, Yvonne.
Hi, everyone. First of all, I want to... Am I too loud? First of all, I want to thank you guys for letting us speak at your seminar to say a few words, and we'll be brief because I'm not feeling too brave today, and I forget which language to speak or how to speak it. So we're just going to read out a few things we want to say, and for those who don't know us, my name is Igor.
I'm Lena.
This is my wife, Lena. In Russian, it sounds Igorь.
Elena.
Lena. So, yeah, take it away, Lena.
I think a lot has been covered. It was pretty colorful, passionate presentation by Mary. So I don't really find a lot that probably can stand up to it in details, though we have self-reflected quite a lot before we've decided to speak. Is that where I start? Some of you are aware, just briefly, I guess, about what we've been doing and what's been happening and how we've been doing things and so forth. Some of you are aware that we have been learning about the truth or finding out for more than 3 years, and we have been supporting it in every way we can for now, for over 2 years. And we see the potential that this truth can bring to earth and spirit world. So during this time, the 2 or 3 years, we have done everything we can without really thinking about ourselves or about our own well-being. A lot what's Mary been covering. We were just grateful to the change we could feel within us, and we just kept going. So that the avoidance of some things, it was a lot of work. It's it was a full-time commitment for both of us in helping the truth and editing and filming. But on top of it, we were spending a lot of time finding the ways to financially support ourselves. And last 2 years has been very busy. And we run ourselves quite tired and dry emotionally and financially. So we got, had to be, you know, do our things and pay the bills and everything. And we realized that something was a bit wrong and it felt a bit off, and it was difficult, and we were definitely avoiding some things. So when dealing with the truth daily while editing and hearing it, and the message of love certainly grows on you, and we couldn't ignore the issues of love of self for too long. Has been a while since we have noticed the lack of appreciation, but it has taken us quite some time to work through some and still plenty of the reasons why we have not been supported much for the work we've done. Fear and guilt has been the main feelings in both of us since we are reading our thoughts today. It is obviously still quite present. However, while feeling through our issues, we have also realized that in these equations, there are more than just the two of us involved. So we love the journey and love helping the beautiful chance to occur. We love to see that we can somehow save guys some time and also serve you all by being in our own passion. But we also see that it is all of us who can be a part of the change. We feel the path to God is an individual journey. It is a uniting journey at the same time. So many hours of truth and direct assistance is available online for free for anyone who is searching. We also feel by offering ourselves freely, we're very much open to being taken advantage of in some way, and speaking up about ourselves with all of you is a part of our own journey and feeling about issues of self-love. We feel there is a lot of anger in all of us, especially about money. So something we've self-reflected is that this anger affects us on how we're capable to appreciate things. In this feeling, the anger doesn't allow us to desire, or helps us to sort of want things and expect them always to be available to us, taking them without thinking or reflecting on it. So we wanted to share a few words on our more self-reflection. And during this journey, since the 3 years ago, a few things we've learned. If the arrow is left uncorrected or unnoticed, it will not go away on its own. Fear of confrontation will prolong the unloving situation until such a time when the pain is bigger than the fear. I think we may have reached that point. Fear is still strong, though. If there are issues of love with another or self-love, the situation needs to be corrected and issues need to be addressed, else no change for the better can ever occur. Something else we've learned. By confronting the issue of love, it starts the chain of the change within all individuals. Or at least there is an opportunity for it. With their own issues about that matter, such as do we have a desire to learn more, or do we even have appreciation for what we have been given? Or why do I even have this lack, the lack of abundance? Why can't I follow my desires? When working with truth cannot be from the distance, something we've learned, and it has to be from your heart, and your heart must be open for it. Desiring to spread the truth to everyone who wants it can be a way of living. It is for us, and we have learned that being a volunteer as we are, it is about passion for truth, it is about commitment, and it is about getting work done. It is about being available and desiring to work. We have noticed for some time the lack of enthusiasm and the lack of desire to learn in people who attend the seminars and book groups. Probably just being behind the camera is probably one of the advantages of just seeing all your faces, and obviously it is very visible to when you stand here. Being there and then editing the material gives a bit of a different perspective on things. We feel the desire sort of died off a while back, and we could see that most people would just come along, but we weren't really sure why. It does seem apparent that it is all of us who need the truth. We are the seekers at the moment, and Jesus and Mary already know it, as they say, and they teach it to us. So do we really want to learn anything they know? And do we really want to grow? Something we've self-reflected on ourselves as well. And the appreciation or the lack of it coming towards the truth, the videos and everything seems to indicate otherwise. And another reason we wanted to bring things up is that it wasn't fair to some of the local people who carry and support. So this is why we speak again in a bigger public. And this message will be available through YouTube for everyone who listens the Divine Truth. We do feel it is not fair to generous people, as they feel they almost need to be more generous. And we wanted to thank Jesus and Mary and a few families. I think most know who they are. You have been very generous with us. And without your support, we wouldn't have been able to do as much work as we have done. We've listed some of the commitments that we've discovered involving working with Divine Truth. Assisting Jesus and Mary has been the most joyful experience, and there are no timings or pressure or any expectations from them ever. It always has been about serving people and delivering a beautiful gift. However, hasn't been easy. Personally, there is an urgency that we have always felt in a loving way for the truth to become available as soon as possible. We feel this is the most important information available on Earth at this time. Therefore, it requires level of commitment and responsibility on our part. There are always projections from people and spirits that we have to deal with, which we're still sort of battling emotionally and fears, obviously. There are personal emotions, technical malfunctions, interruptions, and so forth. On the other hand, there is so much more information available for us all, but it requires us time to organize it, and release it. Time is a precious resource. We have learned many ways to save time, but mainly by learning new skills. And skills, it has taken many years for us to obtain skills that are required to complete this work. Skills came from learning using our personal time and effort. There's also availability factor, to have a desire to be available for all of the events. And as Mayor mentioned, there are volunteers come every time and they're pretty much similar people. The turnaround and delivery of an outcome. If we said we'll do it and then didn't, many would miss out on hearing about what has been delivered during the seminar. We also find that it's important to be financially self-sufficient rather than reliant or demand. And we have been supported by Centrelink for a couple of years, and we've realized there is a big issue of ethics and truth in it, because Centrelink is for unemployed people and we found ourselves quite employed. So there was something bigger that we looked at, and speaking up today, probably one of the little steps that we're taking and to address the issues of self-love and self-worth. One of the other commitments we've discovered, desire for the truth, big one. And the purity of our desire to volunteer. That's the end of my list.
Is it?
Yep.
Okay, I'll just make sure.
Do you want to say something?
Yeah, and last month and this month is the first time that we have received enough donation to actually leave and cover the basics and everything. So thanks for everyone who donated, and yeah, keep going. Thanks guys for listening.
Thanks guys. And can I just add our thanks to those people who have donated. Since the last book group, there's been quite a number of people overseas who have donated to us, and we are very appreciative to that. And also to those of you who do place donations in our donation box, we are really grateful that you've enabled us to go this far. So thank you guys.
I feel it's quite sad though, in a way, that Lena and Igor have been helping for nearly 2 years, and for the last 2 months is the only times they've been able to cover their expenses from donations. So that means for 22 months they've lived in arrears constantly and scraped by, as many of you know. And and we've actually said to Lita and Igor that unless we can see them being totally supported by the donations, we don't want them to be doing as much work as they're currently doing, because we don't think it's ethically right to ask them to continue doing as much work as they're actually doing, getting all these videos up and all of this editing done and a lot of other things that they're currently doing, when we can't support them through donations. So we'd love to, we feel quite strongly that our costs of living are lower than Lena and Igor's.
They have to pay rent.
You know, they have to pay rent. We don't have to pay rent because we own our property. They badly need a decent vehicle. We've got a decent vehicle or two, so we don't need a vehicle. We purchase most of the hardware that they use to do all of their editing work and so forth, but the reality is that we sort of feel like unless the guys can be supported doing what they're doing from donations they receive, then we can't really continue offering the service of doing videos for people, and ethically do so. So that's something that we feel quite strongly about.
Yeah, and in a way I feel that we've left these kind of decisions too late. Not too late, but
we needed to make them much sooner. So that was the case with Book Group, and I feel for Lena and Igor as well.
And it is true that Lena and Igor and Mary over the last 2 years have been going against some of my suggestions about dealing with these issues.
Very resistive. All three of us agree? The thought of actually, a month ago, the thought of standing up here and actually giving this talk sent me into a mute, completely intellectually absent state. I couldn't speak, I couldn't think, I can't do that. So, and I know it was the same for Lena and Igor. Yeah.
And the three of them have been quite resistive until I got quite firm about the subject, as you can imagine, as I do sometimes. But I just feel from an ethical stance, we've all got to consider, we benefit a lot from what they do, from what Lena and Igor do in particular, but also from what others do who are here volunteering their time without much consideration of how they live their life, you know. And to be honest with you, thank you does not pay the rent. And thank you doesn't put food on your table. And thank you doesn't pay for the bills that you have. There has to be some other action to pay for those particular things. And we feel quite strongly that if you don't appreciate what Lena and Igor in particular do for you, then that's fine, you don't have to, but they need to stop doing what they're doing if that's the case. Because we're giving to people who obviously don't want the gift. Now, if you do appreciate it, then what we'd love... That's me gone.
Here, take me.
Yeah, and if we do appreciate it, then demonstrate that appreciation consistently. You know from your own day-to-day life that you have bills every month. If you're paying rent, you pay rent every week. You know you've got these consistent bills coming up regularly. And so, if you know that about your life, you surely know that about theirs. And that is something to consider. Myself and Mary, like our personal income, like I mentioned, is about $17,000 a year. And we have given to Lena and Igor about $11,000 in the last year. But to us, that's like still not enough for them to live. They need, my calculation is they'd need $30,000 to $40,000 a year to live. And we can't really expect them to keep doing what they're doing without addressing this issue. Does that make sense? So we'd like to thank you, particularly thank all of those of you who have been regularly donating, and thank those of you who do donate at this time. But we also want you to bear in mind these particular things that have been brought up, which one of which is in particular the value that you place upon what you're receiving. Unfortunately, as statistics bear out, based on what Mary has presented, many of you don't value an hour of divine truth above a cup of coffee. Now, when I work that out, a cup of coffee at the most will last you 15 minutes. So that means 4 cups of coffee an hour. It would be equivalent to an hour. What a cup of coffee costs you nowadays? I don't know, because I haven't bought one for a long time.
How much, please?
About $5. So 4 cups of coffee, $20. So you value divine truth at 1/10 of a cup of coffee. That's the average value placed upon divine truth. Now, if I was a person who took offence, I could take offence at that. It's a good thing I'm not a person who takes offence. Also, if I felt punishing, a long time ago I would have stopped doing what I'm doing. But I'm not a person who feels like punishing either. But it is an issue that I feel we need to address, and particularly an issue that we need to address if we're going to see divine truth grow on the planet. We're going to have a break now for around 45 minutes, and then we'll talk to you about what's happening with the God's Way of Love organisation. Okay? Okay.